deep in a missile silo or a hardened bunker of some sort, because I spent so much of my time talking about my various ways in which horrifically awful things could happen, so I'm quite delighted to find myself at a conference in which we're spending our whole day on that subject. And I'm joking about it, but I'm actually quite serious. I am stunned. I live in Alexandria, Virginia, right outside of Washington, D.C. I spend my time inside the Beltway, and it's quite stunning to me how cavalier, at least in that inside the Beltway world, we have become about some of just the existential threats to human civilization. I hear people tell me all the time, with complete seriousness, things like, well, we've had nuclear weapons for more than 70 years now, and we haven't had a nuclear apocalypse yet, so I think that shows we've really learned how to manage this. And I think, no, it doesn't. It just shows that we haven't blown ourselves up yet. 70 years in the grand scheme of human history is the blink of an eye. It shows us nothing whatsoever. And I think that trying to find a way to feel these threats in our bones is absolutely critical to beginning to create the legal architectures, and even more important, I'm going to talk about this, the bureaucratic and cultural architectures that minimize the likelihood that we do indeed end up with some sort of catastrophic outcome. But let me just take a step from the profound back to the mundane. I'm going to try to really quickly run through several different questions. One, are there legal constraints against a presidential first use of nuclear weapons? Two, should there be legal constraints? Three, are there practical constraints? Are there bureaucratic cultural constraints separate from those legal constraints, if any? And then actually the fourth part of my talk has the title Some Random Thoughts, so we'll get to the random thoughts after that. So number one, are there clear legal constraints against a presidential nuclear first use? Notwithstanding my dear friend Bruce Ackerman, I would have to say no, there aren't. And what I mean by that is that although there are certainly strong arguments that we can make about the War Powers Act, about the constitutional balance of power between Congress and the presidency, and so forth, that partly because of the reasons that Bruce was suggesting towards the end of his talk, they tend to be outweighed by the arguments made by smart lawyers sitting in the White House and the State Department and so on, which ends up meaning that there is no actual legal bar in practice. And let me give an example on it. I think this is what Bruce was talking about towards the very end, and I hope we'll say more about this in the questions. The decision to use force in Libya under the Obama administration, you will not find a president more committed in theory to the rule of law than President Obama was. Certainly, I think it's a sharp contrast to our current situation. And yet, in part due to some forum shopping and so on and so forth, despite what seemed like a rather clear prohibition on using force without congressional authorization through the War Powers Act and so forth, the Obama administration did precisely that because Harold Coe, my friend and Bruce's, made a series of arguments about the ways in which bombing from the sky did not count as a deployment of U.S. troops and so on and so forth, and we used force anyway, and there was no consequence. There were nobody impeached Obama, you know, there were a few sort of noises made in the press, people like us made noises, nothing happened. So I don't think, much as we would like to say, when Bruce says things like the president cannot use force in North Korea without congressional assent, I think the asterisk to that cannot, unfortunately, he sort of can, because we can't stop it, and we don't have the mechanisms that exist to translate that in some neat, simple, automatic way into stopping. You would think it should be enough to say, gee, Mr. President, the text here is pretty clear, you can't do that. And yet it turns out no. There's also, and I won't talk about what I know my colleague John Burroughs here will be talking about in a few minutes, the international law framework. There's no unambiguous international legal prohibition on the use of nuclear weapons. In 1996, for instance, the International Court of Justice issued an advisory opinion on nuclear weapons and came to the not terribly satisfying conclusion that although the use of nuclear weapons would be, quote, generally contrary to international law, that the court cannot conclude definitively whether the use of nuclear weapons would be lawful or unlawful in an extreme up for matters of this level of significance. Two, should there be a legal constraint? Hell yeah. And I think Elaine Scarry's book, Nuclear Monarch, I think says this much better than I can. I think in all kinds of ways, both on the level of textualism, when you think about the text of the Constitution itself, when you think of the text of existing legislation, but also when you think more deeply about norms, about what does it mean to have a democracy, why do we have this Constitution in the first place, yes, investing this level of world-destroying power in the hands of one or even a few is deeply and profoundly counter to any vision, certainly the framers of the American Republic could ever have conceived of, and I think would have been utterly horrifying to them. I think that one of the points that Elaine has made in her work is the ways in which the existence of weapons that can kill so many people, where decisions rest in the hands of so few, are always profoundly undemocratic. And I do, as an asterisk here, would say that there are also all kinds of ways in which many of our other modern methods of warfare have profoundly anti-democratic implications. There's a terrific book called Forged Through Fire by political scientists John Fearjohn and Francis McCall Rosenbluth that points out the historical connections between the evolution of democracy, the expansion of the suffrage, the granting of political rights to large numbers of people on the one hand, and the existence of manpower-intensive forms of warfare on the other hand. And to put it very simplistically, when elites need the masses because they need to throw them at other masses in wars, then they trade off by granting rights to ordinary people. When forms of warfare are high tech, et cetera, don't require a lot of human beings to go out and get themselves killed, you tend to have the opposite effect, that you get a contraction of democracy. And I do think that we face similar threats when it comes to things like autonomous weapons or drone warfare and so forth. If you don't need to say to the population of the nation, you need to risk your lives, then you can make, if you are a political leader, you can make decisions much less democratically and much less responsibly. So let me shift to, are there practical constraints on a presidential first use of nuclear weapons? And here I think the answer is some, but not quite as many as, it's a slender read. There are obviously, the first panel discussed, this isn't magic. It's not that the president wakes up one morning and says, nuke China, poof, and it happens that in order to nuke China, you have to have created a bureaucratic apparatus that is designed to nuke China. You have to have the right missiles in the right place with the right codes and the right geography programmed into them. And you do go through a chain, and in under any kind of normal circumstances, there are lots of other people who are involved in those decisions. So at least in a strictly hypothetical sense, when it comes to first use, as opposed to, oh no, Mr. President, 200 Soviet missiles are already on their way, you've got 2 minutes, decide. At least when it comes to first use, yes, lots of people would probably be involved in those decisions, and there is a possibility. And indeed, I think when it comes to the use of nuclear weapons in North Korea, a strong likelihood that there would be lots of voices very close to the president saying, Mr. President, this is not a good idea, let's talk about this, and trying to slow that down. I do think it's worth distinguishing in our arguments between the hypotheticals involving the insane decisions versus simply catastrophically reckless and unwise decisions. Because I'm actually reasonably confident that if Donald Trump or any other American president just wakes up one morning and goes, aha, I'm going to nuke Canada, go, that there are enough constraints in place, enough people who say, wait a minute, Mr. President, I can't work the law on the nuclear football, it's kind of broken right now, we better call the Secretary of Defense, get him over here. By the way, have I mentioned, you know, the 25th Amendment and so on? I'm not actually that worried about the literal insanity. You know, the president is just drunk out of his mind, or he's crazy, or just has an epileptic fit, or he's kind of nuts. I think that the bigger thing to worry about is, as it has always been, the reckless extraordinarily unwise decision, which I don't think gets made in 5 minutes, and unfortunately, I don't think that involving more people, the Attorney General, the Secretary of Defense, necessarily stops it. Groups, particularly homogeneous groups, particularly in a hierarchical setting, where people are habituated to abiding by the decision of the commander-in-chief, are not necessarily likely to put meaningful brakes on a presidential decision, even though they might regard it as unwise. I think about our current Secretary of Defense, a very thoughtful guy, a guy who's made it crystal clear that he personally thinks the use of nuclear weapons in North Korea would be a bad idea. I can't imagine him faced with a president who said, I've heard you, you've told me that over and over, but I'm going to do it. Being willing to say, no, sir, I will throw my body in the way, you can't do that. Because the tradition of civilian obedience, military obedience to civilian control, I think runs very deeply and very deeply internalized. Is it impossible that anyone who is part of those discussions, all the way down to the launch officers, says, no, I won't do it? That's crazy. That it's possible. It's possible. It's not likely. It's not very likely at all. I think what we know about human beings in that kind of environment, given the context, is that very few of them even have the courage that that Soviet nuclear officer had to say, this is a false alarm, I'm not going to do anything. It takes extraordinary courage, and it's extraordinarily rare, and it's certainly not something that you can count on. So a little bit to feel a little better on, the completely whacked out thing, I don't think we need to spend that much time worrying about the completely wacky thing. In part because, as Bruce Blair tells us, the attack plans are not, people don't come up with them at the last minute, you know, but they are the product of months and years of planning and programming and the creating of these architectures. Could the president hypothetically say, I've changed my mind, I'm leaving Canada instead? Sure, he could. But the system is not designed to do that. It would take a while for everybody to kind of go, oh, Canada, wait, well, where in Canada, you know, which weapons, et cetera. And the operational plans themselves have been vetted by all of the lawyers. That doesn't necessarily create a huge amount of comfort, but certainly, at least in principle, they are gone over to look for things like compliance with principles of military necessity, proportionality, and distinction, and so forth. So I'm less worried about the crazy decision than I am just about the sort of run-of-the-mill and unwise decision. And here's my final point. Here's the sort of random thought here. I do think it's important for those of us who care deeply about reining in this awesome catastrophic power to disaggregate and to draw careful distinctions when we talk about this. We tend to talk about, look at the 800 kiloton or megaton bomb and it wipes out the world, and we go, oh God, we don't want that to happen. Here's what happens in Washington when you say that. Everybody says, ho, 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 don't you know, that's not what we're talking about. Nobody would do that. Nobody would be crazy enough to do that. Of course not. What we're talking about is we're talking about designing little tiny tailored tactical nuclear weapons with just little tiny few kilotons in them. And we would only use them in very special circumstances, and we would use them for the, you know, the hardened bunker that we couldn't get through other means or so on. And there's, you know, you have this idea that nuclear weapons are all the same. Well, they're not. We would only think about using the little ones that are very tailored and precise, and so your notion of world catastrophe immediately occurring is just goofy. I think that there is an answer to that, and I think there are many in here who have thought much harder about how to articulate the response to that. And the answer has something to do with the ways in which even a tactical, small-scale, precise use of nuclear weapons runs an unbelievably high risk of escalation, deliberate or inadvertent, and an unbelievably high risk of normalization of the use of nuclear weapons, no matter how inadvertent. But I think it's really important that we make those arguments and not rest our arguments solely on the, but you don't want to blow up the world, do you? Because everybody will say, of course not, that's silly, that's a red herring, here's what we're really talking about, and you can't just say that they're all the same, you have to grapple with that. And I think that that's absolutely right. So I've got a little time's up thing stuck up here, so I'm gonna bring this to a close. The only thing I will say, coming back to my theme at the beginning about the ways in which we ourselves tend to, you live with the threat for so long that it stops seeming real. But I think that we need to find ways, all of us, and to communicate to all of our friends and neighbors and people who are not our friends as well. This sense of urgency, it's a little bit like the, you know, those people who, you know, say, oh, I live with the grizzly bears and I can hang out with grizzlies, or I'm a crocodile tamer, the crocodile won't bite me, I know it. You know, that over time they become so habituated to the presence of this dangerous predator that they tend to forget it's a dangerous predator, and then they get eaten by their grizzly bear or the crocodile or whatever. I think we're in a similar situation when it comes to these technologies. We're so used to living in the shadow of apocalypse that it stops seeming dangerous to us. But just like the, you know, the grizzly man or whoever, I think we should never forget that we are living with a dangerous predator, the only difference being that this time the predator in many ways is